name is Holly Rowe. I'm the president of the Birmingham Aero Club, and on behalf of the Aero Club and the Southern Museum of Flight, I'd like to welcome you here tonight. This is a very big year in aviation, both in the world and in the state of Alabama. This is the centennial of licensed women pilots, so it's appropriate that we're here tonight to recognize one of them. It is the centennial of powered flight. In the state of Alabama, the Wright brothers started their flight school in Montgomery 100 years ago, and we had a very good program on that not too long back in the Aero Club. This was also the year, I believe, that the WASP was recognized with the Congressional Gold Medal, and we're going to be hearing a little bit more about that very shortly. And last but not least, in case you didn't know it, Happy Aviation Day. This is National Aviation Day in the United States, and I can't think of a more appropriate evening to be here. At this time, I'm going to ask Dr. Ed Stevenson with the Alabama Aviation Hall of Fame to come up and introduce our speaker.
Originally met Sarah, I guess 12 years ago. I'm going to let Sarah do the rest of the talking, and I just want to welcome her back to Alabama and give her the rest of the evening to tell it all. Sarah?
First, I have to tell you that the reason I am here tonight, Ed kind of alluded to it, it is all because of Nancy Batson Cruz and the people of Alabama who welcomed me when I came down to talk to her about doing the book she asked me to write. So I owe a lot to you all. I was here once before with the book that she challenged me to write, and the Aero Club and the museum welcomed me with open arms, and I've never forgotten that. Nancy learned to fly at the University of Alabama. And that's what you see here with her instructor, who was, I think, 2 years older than she was. And it was a program called the Civilian Pilot Training Program, which I know all of you all as aviators know what it is. And I love this, because that's what it was like at the University of Alabama and a lot of other college campuses. And he liked the women flight instructors. So. I love this shot because this reminds me of Nancy Eaton when she was 80. I don't think she changed that much. Well, while she was down at Embry-Riddle, life changed again. Nancy Love was tasked with recruiting women pilots to ferry airplanes for the Army Air Forces. And Nancy read about it and she said, "That's where I belong." Well, this was the first big ferrying trip that the girls took. And what they were flying, you can see behind them are six Stearmans, PT-17s, open cockpit. And they are supposed to take these planes to Jackson, Tennessee. The Canadians had them, and they found out that they couldn't fly those open cockpit planes up in Canada in the winter. It was just too daggone cold. So actually, there were 33 planes that were supposed to go back to Jackson, and 27 men and the six women were to ferry them. Now, ferrying an open cockpit airplane with not very big, no instruments, as you well know, and not a very big fuel tank, it took them 3 weeks. Of course, weather had a problem with weather, too. The morning they took off from Great Falls, the temperature was below zero, and they had to heat the oil in order to get it in the crankcase so they could take off. They actually beat all 27 men there. The girls got a reputation real early for delivering very quickly. I mean, if you want to consider 3 weeks quickly, but under the circumstances, it worked. All of the men who flew for the Air Force, so the Air Forces during World War II, went through the primary trainer, basic trainer, and advanced trainer, and then on up into others, but the women were sent through the exact same three airplanes.
Ones who were good enough, they decided they could ferry the pursuits, and Nancy Love was the first one who did it. She ferried a P-51, flew a P-51 in February 1943, paved the way. So they set up pursuit school in December in Palm Springs, and that is Nancy That's not at pursuit school, that's later, but the first one she flew was the P-47, and she flew more P-47s than any other pursuit airplane.
She flew in all 22 kinds of airplanes, and they're listed over in the exhibit. In April, she went to officer training school because the women were going to be taken into the Air Forces, and Jackie Cochran, who headed the WASP, and the WASPs were now part of the WASP, wanted to send the more experienced girls to officer training. Nancy was in the first class.
And she's the one with her head turned around. You can probably see her there. And her biggest assignment, one she spent the most time at, was at Farmingdale, New York, flying P-47s from the Republic factory over to Newark. And there's the alert room and three of the gals waiting.
The other gal sitting on the railing is Sis Burnham, who was also one of the original WAFs, and the other girl is Jane Strawn, who was in the very first WASP class to graduate. It all came to an end before the war was over. The WASP were disbanded in December 1944 because the men were coming back, the men who had flown all their missions were coming back, and they wanted the women's jobs. They were able to take them. Also, Hap Arnold had canceled the flight training classes for cadets early in 44 because he realized he had more than enough pilots trained. Their losses were far fewer than they ever thought they would be. And all of that impacted the movement to try to militarize the WASP in the spring of 1944. And Hap Arnold wanted it. He went to bat for it, but it's the first time that Congress ever turned him down. And they did not militarize the WASP. And that eventually led to their disbanding in December 1944. The crown of glory, at age 79 and 80, she was a corporate co-pilot in a King Air. And Chris, the pilot she flew with, Chris, took this picture of her. Let's go back to the gold medal, because this is the latest. That was July 09, and you see there are three WASP there with the president, Bea Haidu, Elaine Harmon, and Lorraine Rogers. That is Nancy's gold medal. I was able to receive it for the family. I collected it for them, took it home, took a picture, and then sent it on to Radford. And her legacy, as far as I'm concerned, is her own biography. It's long. There we go. You know, I think Nancy never met a stranger, and they loved her. The women loved her. Not just guys were crazy about her, but the women loved her. She was the kind of person that everybody, she drew people to her. But she was about as single-minded. It was her way or the highway, I found out. And that's what made her who and what she was. Because she knew what was right for her, and she did it. Am I right, Luther? Yeah.
I invite all of you to tour the new exhibit. We have three uniforms back in the back, and many of the artifacts that belong to Nancy Cruz. One of the uniforms was shipped to us from a museum in California. I think you'll really enjoy this. And also tonight we brought down her Hall of Fame plaque so that all of you could see it here on this side. And then right after you have a chance to tour the exhibit, I think we're going to open up the hors d'oeuvres. And thank you so much for coming to the museum tonight.